capital officer of the United States shall be removed from office upon impeachment for and conviction of high crimes and misdemeanors. This president commits high crimes and misdemeanors every day. Stand up for the Constitution. You are our hope. We have to work together relentlessly. We have to reach out. We have to tell every congressperson next November, you're out if you're not for impeachment. We demand constitutional integrity. Let's do it. Let's sing along the way. Let's believe we can and we will overcome.
Dupuy, the former ambassador of Haitian President Aristide, who was kidnapped by the Bush administration, and also the Secretary General of the National Popular Party in Haiti.
Thank you. Brothers and sisters, in the 70s, I came to Washington. And there was a huge demonstration against the war in Vietnam. And today, I see the same picture. The Vietnamese fought very hard to protect their independence. But the United States lost the war in the United States. And today, the United States, with George W. Bush, is going to lose the war in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Washington. We know that the Bush administration has come with a concept of regime change. They have another concept, preemptive war. Preemptive war has a meaning. It's a war of aggression. And this is condemned by international law, by the Charter of the United Nations. No nation has the right to pretend that they can export their democracy. Bush didn't only lie about weapons of mass destruction. He lies about his exporting democracy. This is the biggest lie. How can W. Bush send special forces to Haiti just like Ramsey Clark just explained it? Send special forces to kidnap an elected, democratically elected president. Is that democracy? Is that the kind of democracy we want? We know that Bush claims that certain countries are building weapons of mass destruction when they have the monopoly of weapons of mass destruction. Now they're afraid of certain social movement taking place in Latin America and the Caribbean. Why are they afraid of Cuba? Why are they afraid of Venezuela? Why were they afraid of President Aristide in Haiti? Was it because those countries have weapons of mass destruction? No, they have another weapon. It's the example they're giving that disturb the people in this country who have created pocket of underdevelopment in the country, the richest country in the globe. How can that exist? We have seen what happened in New Orleans. They cared only about the rich people, and they left the other one to fend for themselves. Last night, we inaugurated a tribunal called International Tribunal on Haiti. We had the first session, and we have indicted the men criminals who have been massacring people in the barrios. And we're going to bring those criminals to the International Criminal Court in The Hague. Just like the generals in Argentina, in Chile, who were massacring people, we're going to bring those people. And the 6th of October, Ramsey Clark will head a commission of inquiry to come with evidence of the crime against humanity being committed by W. Bush. Thank you.
Nothing makes us more proud than to stand with our brothers and sisters in the Haitian struggle. May the struggle live on, and may Haiti be free. And now, with a tireless proponent for human rights in the United States and for the Palestinian people, from the Los Angeles 8, a prominent Palestinian American activist, Michel, Shehadeh.
Brothers and sisters, we are all here. We are all together today, united, unified in a noble cause of putting an end to an illegal and unjust war and to bring the troops safe back home. This is an agenda that is worth fighting for. This war was waged on a pack of lies. And when the lies were exposed, that there were no weapons of mass destruction, that there were no relationship between Iraq and Al-Qaeda, that there were no connection between Al-Iraq and 911, the liars changed the lie. The lie now is that they're doing this. They're waging the war and killing Iraqis because they're bringing freedom, human rights, and salvation to Iraq. Do you believe that?
No.
Do you believe that one can kill more than 100,000 Iraqis and still can claim that they're bringing them salvation?
No.
All George Bush have been talking about after 9/11 is that he's going to protect America, that he's going to make America safe. Today, we're telling Bush that you are a bigger disaster than the war, than Katrina, than Rita, than the debt, all combined together. And George Bush keeps telling us that he communicates with God, that God talks to him, that he's doing God's work. And we're telling him today, George Bush, you are on the opposite side of God. That God doesn't like you, he wants you out. We want you out. so we can start the process of cleansing America and the world from the destruction, from the agony that his policies and lies have brought, and begin the ouster of George Bush from the White House into prison. Let me end by telling you, this is just the beginning. We're not gonna end just this war. We're gonna end all wars that are not waged in self-defense. We are gonna be on the side of justice, not against it, as our government is doing in Palestine. We're gonna be on the side of liberation, on the side of the true fighters for democracy, not as oppressors and occupiers in Iraq. So bring the troops home and end the war and impeach George Bush. Thank you.
Our next speaker also hails from Southern California. We have Margaret Prescod from Global Women's Strike, host of Morning Drive Time on Pacifica's radio KPFK.
All right, let's hear the women's voice. I'm here to bring the message from the grassroots women. All right, from tribal people in India to the countryside in Uganda, Africa, to mothers and grandmothers on welfare in South Los Angeles and North Philadelphia, to women and men in Los Teques, Caracas, the Global Women's Strike brings our fiercely anti-war message: invest in caring, not killing. Poverty has a woman's face. Women do most of the work on the world and pay the highest price for war and occupation. As women, we carry the burden of work and world and suffering on our shoulders. Katrina has shown the racist face of genocide, including the genocide of poverty. But it is not only in New Orleans. It is in places like Benton Harbor, Michigan, which is 97% black, and people are earning $8,000 a year, while across the river in St. Joe's, which is overwhelmingly white, they're earning $41,000 a year. Apartheid and racism is alive and well in the United States, and it is killing us. It is also genocide. President Hugo Chavez, I interviewed him with the Democracy Now! Team last week in New York. He said that the $800 billion spent on Iraq right now could begin to address the hunger in Africa, in Asia, in the Caribbean, and in Haiti, and right here in the United States. Corruption, military recruiting, poverty, and criminalization are used to prevent and disrupt grassroots organizing. The movement exists, but we are hidden, and the strike exists, and I'm here today to make it visible. The direction and demands of the grassroots movement must prevail in every movement for change. The revolution in Venezuela has shown us that it is possible to prioritize the caring for people and the environment, and we want that right here in the United States. From Iraq to Palestine to Haiti, we say no to war and occupation. Invest in caring, not killing. 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 Thank you very much.
How's everybody doing? The next speaker is Reverend John Thomas, the President and General Minister of United Church of Christ, representing 3.5 million congregants. Please welcome Reverend John Thomas.
Friends, sisters, and brothers, the peace of God be with you. We're going to march soon. 35 years ago, 35 years ago, I stood where you're standing right now, joining people of faith and others determined to bring an end to the Vietnam War. I was here with a campus group from nearby Gettysburg College, here challenging a war conceived in deception, pursued in arrogance, and destined to undermine the moral credibility of our nation. How is it that we have failed to learn our lessons? 35 years ago, we kept an obscene count with body counts and body bags. We slaughtered innocents. We left many precious members of my generation seared by the moral ambiguity and the violence of that war and by the neglect and the demeaning of our nation. How is it that we have learned so little? 35 years ago, Pete Seeger sang that we were waist deep in the big muddy and that the big fool was telling us to push on. Today, our leaders drive behind tinted glass windows and refuse to listen to a mother's haunting questions, going off to cultivate donors whose pockets they have lined. How is it that we have learned so little? 4 years ago on September 11th, I was in Europe, and the world's embrace of consolation and care and solidarity with us was overwhelming. But we lashed out. We reclaimed a privilege that we thought was only ours, and we rained down violence on the truly vulnerable in the world. Today, when I travel, I no longer hear of the word world's care and solidarity. I hear that they see us as a dangerous nation and they fear us. How is it that we have squandered so much? In recent days, Katrina's fury has rained down on our poorest neighbors. Left Behind has come to mean far more than the title of a series about biblical end times. Left Behind is now the life experience of countless neighbors. Those who lead this nation want nothing else but the church's blessing, the church's silence, the church's complicity. The moral compromise they seek today is the same moral distortion they sought from us 35 years ago. Today, let us say a resounding no. No to the deception. No to the arrogance. No to the moral betrayal of this land. And let us learn lessons we would rather forget. Let us say yes. Yes to the young women and men placed in harm's way to satisfy our vanity. Yes to the poor who have been left behind. Yes to a true sharing of the world's hope as well as the world's hurt. Yes to a God who came not to lead a crusade, but to be among us as one who serves. So let us march not as warriors, not as crusaders, but as servants of the living, the still speaking, the compassionate and merciful God.
Thank you, John Thomas. Are you guys ready to march? We'll be ready for you in just a few minutes. We got some great poets ahead and a couple more speakers, and then we're ready to roll. All right. On August 31st, 2005, three buses set out from Crawford, Texas, carrying members of Gold Star Families for Peace, military and veterans of the Iraq War and previous wars. Please put your hands together and give them an amazing welcome to the Bring Them Home Now tour.
Elliot Adams, Veterans for Peace, the Bring Them Home Now bus tour carries the flame from Camp Casey and passes that flame to you. To honor us vets, you can stop war and stop it now.
Hi, my name is Elaine Johnson from Orangeburg, South Carolina. and I brought four buses with me from South Carolina. And I have, and I think it's over 100 thousands of people that's here. And my message is to President Bush, I'm not the only one that thinks you're a liar. The rest of us thinks you're a liar.
Good afternoon. My name is Ann Rustler, and I'm from Military Family Speak Out. My son is in the 82nd Airborne. He's a staff sergeant currently serving his third deployment to Iraq. He's been in the war zone for over 500 days, and we're still counting. Unlike those who sent our loved ones over, who get to lay and sleep in comfort in their beds at night, my son's sleeping in the sand. I lay awake at night waiting for a call from my son because I haven't heard from him since he deployed the end of August. I lay awake praying to God that I don't get a knock on my front door telling me that he's no longer walking among the living. Chaos is reigning in Iraq. My son says that every single time he goes back, the chaos is worse. He fired more rounds and killed more Iraqis in the second deployment than he did in the entire first year that he was there during the invasion. And he doesn't want the job. He'd love to be able to give his two-week notice. He and I were here about a year ago, when there were many fewer of you out here, and I'm so glad to see so many of you here today. We went to the Vietnam War Memorial to honor the fallen, and as he looked at the wall and read the names, I began to cry, and he put his arm around me and he said, "Mom, I wonder how many names will be on our memorial." It's so time to bring our troops home. Many, many of them don't want to be there, and they are desperate to come home, and they want us to speak out. They cannot speak out because when they wear the uniform, their voices are silenced. My son has asked me, "Where is the media? Where are the people? Don't they care about us?" Our government is not going to bring them home anytime soon. It's up to us to take our country back. It's up to us to bring them home. It's up to us to make sure they're taken care of when they come home. And it's up to us to never, ever allow our government to send our loved ones to war based on lies again. So let's take to the streets. Yeah. Let's show the administration that they are criminals, that this war is illegal, that it is unjust, that it is immoral, that it is racist. And let's bring our troops home. Thank you.
Peace, a national network of people of African heritage working for justice and peace in the U.S. and abroad. Damu Smith.
I've said it once, and I'll say it again. This is the most dangerous government to come to power in the history of the United States of America. We're here today because our government is fighting an illegal, immoral, barbaric, criminal, unnecessary, reckless, and illegal war against the people of Iraq. Our government is providing $6 billion a year in support of Israel's barbaric occupation of the Palestinian people. We're here today because our government left mostly black and poor people stranded at the New Orleans Superdome and at the New Orleans Convention Center, abandoned, stranded, homeless, with no food and no water and no medicine. The same government that deprives our people here in America is the same government waging criminal, occupationist, militarist policies abroad. We've got to bring both of these movements together, the movement for peace and the movement for justice, right here in our neighborhoods, right here in the United States of America. Finally, let me say this. Shame on Bush. Shame on Bush. We will leave here today organizing on the college campuses, organizing in our churches, organizing in our mosques and our synagogues, organizing in our schools, organizing at the civic associations and the recreation centers. Do not just come here for this great assemblage today. Go home and organize everybody into a massive movement to throw these thugs here in Washington, D.C. out of office. We've got to radically restructure our government and build a new society here and abroad. We must say, end the war in Iraq. Remember Katrina. End the war in Iraq. Come on. Remember Katrina. End the war in Iraq. Remember Katrina. God bless you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Damu. I have an announcement here that Anthony Dico, come to the Red Cross tent. Anthony Dico, please come to the Red Cross tent. Our next speaker is George Martin from Peace Action, Wisconsin, the Green Party US, and National Co-Chair of United for Peace and Justice.
Thank you. United for Peace and Justice, we are. United for Peace and Justice, more than 1,400 groups and coalitions across this country. We're the coalition that brought 500,000 people to demonstrate at the Republican Convention. We're the coalition that continues to drive this whole weekend of anti-war activities. We say no to the Bush agenda. We say no to war, to hate, to lies, to greed. We say end this occupation and bring our troops home now. You know, earlier this year I was in Brazil at the World Social Forum, 150,000 people. By chance, I ran into the most awesome, inspiring man that me and many of our friends had met in all of Iraq, Sheikh Jawad al-Khalisi. It gave us a chance to talk. You know, the first thing he said to me, he said, George, what are you Americans doing? We're dying over here. Our kids are starving. And I tell you, I told him what we're doing is continuing to grow this movement, to grow and build up to today. The movement is growing. It's happening. That we today are standing together, shoulder to shoulder, going back home to the heartlands, going back home to the in cities, inner cities, going back home to all of the various different places of America as one people, saying that we, the people, demand justice roll down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. We who believe in freedom cannot rest until it comes.
Our next speaker is none other than the president of the Muslim American Society, Dr. Esam Omeish.
Peace be upon all. We in the Muslim American Society stand side by side, shoulder by shoulder, with our brothers and sisters. We represent the largest grassroots Muslim organization in the States, chapters across the nation. We speak the voice and conscience of the Muslim community in America, and we say it loud and clear with our brothers and sisters. No, no to war. Bring our troops home. We support our troops and we want them home. My brothers and sisters, we have a different vision for America than the vision that George Bush and the White House have for America. We have a vision for America where we're leading the world, not by force and aggression, but leading the world by resolve and example, where America is prosperous and charitable, not floundering and bankrupt. We have a vision for America where everybody, every religious community, every ethnicity is side by side, building a great America, not the divided America that Bush and his cronies want for us. We have a vision for America where we are a great nation because we cherish freedom and we cherish democracy and we cherish civil liberties, not the America that's turning into a police state, the one that's eroding the very foundations upon our which our country is built. We stand side by side as Muslims, as Americans, and as patriots to make America a better place, to make it a more virtuous and prosperous place, a more just and principled place where freedom is, where faith is over fear and justice for all. Bring the troops home. Bring the troops home and faith over fear and justice for all. Thank you and God bless.
Our next speakers are Mounzer Sleiman, Vice Chair of the National Council of Arab Americans, and after him will be Musa Al-Hindi from Al-Awda National.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the largest demonstration against the war. And we Arab Americans, we're calling on our community to open their hearts and pocketbooks and give generously to the victims of Katrina and now Rita. The misplaced priorities of this administration of funding war abroad at the expense of the need of the peoples here, Arab Americans, has been at the receiving end of devastation of war abroad in the Arab and Islamic world and the savagery of the so-called war on terror at home that has fueled hatred, racism, bigotry, and unlawful detention. We live in a virtual concentration camp of fear, harassment, and intimidation. Arab Americans demand and deserve respect. We will not be labeled as suspect. We are not visitors nor tourists in this country. We are an integral part of this society and its cultural fabric. You'll find Arab American in all walks of life. We, like many communities in this nation, have been at the core of making America what it is today. But there has been a deliberate effort to marginalize Arab Americans and exclude them from the national dialogue. We want America to lead in advancing the case of justice and peace and not the America of war, domination, and the illusion of empire building. It is our patriotic duty to dissent and reject the reckless policy of the Bush administration that is harming America and the world through the illusion of a war and through the illegal and immoral war on Iraq. We are Arab Americans. We believe in America that it is at peace with itself and the world. We demand the end of occupation of Iraq, the end of occupation of Palestine. There is no peace without justice. There is no democracy under occupation. Thank you.
I am a Palestinian refugee, and I am here to raise the voice of the refugees of Palestine. I'm here to represent Al-Awda, the Palestine Right to Return Coalition. I'm here to give a voice to the tireless determination of the Palestinian refugees to return to their homes and lands in Palestine. The Palestinian people in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip are the vanguard of the Palestinian revolution today, but the people in the refugee camps in exile are a strategic depth. It was the refugees who planted and nourished the seeds of the Palestinian revolution. It was the refugees who turned their camps into barriers when the movement and the revolution was attacked and tried to be strangled. Let me put it shortly. Palestine is the refugees, and the refugees are Palestine. I'm here to tell you that the voice of Palestine will never be extinguished, not by the settler colonial state of Israel, nor by any of its apologists in the United States. The world cannot reject racism, but expect the people of Palestine to accept it. Our vision of Palestine is that of a secular, democratic state over the entirety of the land of Palestine, from the river to the sea. The establishment of a democratic Palestinian state would not only allow for the return of the refugees, would also free the Palestinian people under the yoke of occupation, and will free our enemies from their racism. The democratic vision of Palestine that we offer stands in contradiction to the illegitimate, to the racist vision offered and manifested by the Zionist movement through the State of Israel. Long live Palestine, one Arab, indivisible and free from the river to the sea.
Brothers and sisters, this person needs no introduction. You know him. Please meet and greet and get a thunderous round of applause for Ralph Nader.
Friends and citizens who have come here on this historic day, September 24th, 2005, to demand that our hijacked government reverse its treacherous and dangerous course in the occupation and war in Iraq, a government hijacked by a small clique of warmongers, led by the President and Vice President of the United States. It's important, of course, for all people to realize that you are here representing a reverse of federal government policy over there that is shared by a majority of the American people, and a growing majority. 62% of the American people now say that the invasion of Iraq was a mistake. Almost 70% say it wasn't worth the price. 60% want out of Iraq. Representing the majority of the American people here is an important asset for you to go back home and organize with a laser-type focus on the U.S. Congress. Already, we are within 100 votes in the House of Representatives passing a resolution demanding that the White House establish an exit strategy. That's 100 votes short. There's a lot of ferment going on in the U.S. Congress that can be accentuated and punctuated by the folks back home when you go there. It's also important to know that this war and occupation in Iraq was the first war in American history opposed by a majority of retired admirals, generals, intelligence officials, and former diplomats. More than a few of them spoke out when many of us here were trying to stop this invasion of Iraq. Admiral Shanahan spoke out, former head of the Pacific Fleet. Retired Marine General Anthony Zinni spoke out repeatedly, and the Washington Post said his views were shared by most of the military officers. The U.S. Army and the Pentagon was against the invasion of Iraq because they saw no strategic purpose. They saw it would divert attention from focus on pursuing stateless terrorists, that it would get us into a quagmire, and that there would not be enough resources to fulfill even a misguided strategy. The State Department informed George W. Bush that his assertions, which were the rationale for the invasion, were not substantiated. Here is a president who plunged our nation into an unconstitutional and illegal war based on a platform of fabrications, lies, deceptions, and cover-up. George W. Bush must be held accountable under Article 2, Section 4 of the United States Constitution. Our founding fathers provided that the Congress, and the Congress alone, has the authority to fire the president for high crimes and misdemeanors. There has not been a more impeachable president in our country's history. He is and was the perpetrator, the progenitor, the promoter, the purveyor, the prevaricator, and the presider over this illegal criminal war that is jeopardizing our own national security here at home and abroad. When the head of the CIA tells the Senate that the war in Iraq is creating more and more terrorists who will go back skilled to their countries, we should listen. When Walter Jones, Republican from North Carolina, booster of the war, now has turned against the president in no uncertain terms, we should listen. When increasingly Republicans themselves are meeting in the Congress, often with Democrats, to see how they can establish a strategy to get out the war, we should listen. And we should also listen. We should also listen when someone as conservative as Congressman John Duncan, who says that this undeclared and unnecessary war should be opposed, not only because of the deaths, but because there's nothing conservative about a war with its massive deficit spending. I urge you to log in to democracyrising.us, which will keep you current with the increasing turnaround in Congress. I urge you to encourage people to run next year for local, state, and national office on an anti-war, a pro-peace, and pro-justice platform, the way Kevin Zeese is running for the Senate in the state of Maryland. And finally, let there be no mistake that George W. Bush is the leading underminer of the soldiers in Iraq. He has left them to die without adequate armor. He does not count the injuries when they're not in combat, disrespecting the soldiers and their families. And when they come home, he cuts their budget for health care and pharmaceutical products. It's important to note, finally, that all of us have a central responsibility of citizenship here. George W. Bush doesn't speak for America. He doesn't speak for that flag that ends with the allegiance phrase, with liberty and justice for all. He doesn't speak for a majority of American people who oppose him. And it's time to make that majority into a powerful political force with a laser beam focus on Washington, D.C. Thank you.
Thank you, Al.
Brothers and sisters, another person who needs no introduction, star of the silver screen, please greet actress Jessica Lange.
Well, it's always an honor to be here with you. We're here again. And I understand George Bush is not here again. God forbid he should ever be anywhere where he could actually understand how the American people feel. However, I did read a quote of his. He did acknowledge our presence here today. He said, quote, "I recognize their good intentions, but their position is wrong." Withdrawing our troops would make the world more dangerous. And yet, here he is with another example of this man's propensity to lie. There have been twice as many terrorist attacks in the 3 years since 9/11 than in the 3 years preceding 9/11. All their reasons for waging war on Iraq have been proven to be manipulation of facts, untruths, and lies, lies, and more lies. And then he dares accuse us of being guilty of wrong thinking. A man who traffics in deadly lies. The front man for an administration who came into office with the intention of taking out Saddam and becoming an occupying force in Iraq. Members of the Project for the New American Century, who promote an ideology of US domination through the use of force, who have imposed their politics of scorch and burn on the American people and made us complicit against our will in their regime of shame. And who are these men? Who are these men? Let's talk for a minute about these masters of war. These same men that are sending our sons and our daughters, our brothers and sisters, our mothers and fathers to fight an undeclared, an unconstitutional, an unwinnable war for them. Let's talk about their service records. Karl Rove did not serve. Paul Wolfowitz did not serve. Richard Pearl, Douglas Fife, Elliot Abrahams, Newt Gingrich did not serve. Jeb Bush did not serve. The list goes on and on. And we know George W. did not really serve. And yet they expect the ultimate sacrifice from us. More than 1,900 American soldiers dead. Tens of thousands, a very low estimate. Tens of thousands Iraqi deaths, mostly civilian, and in modern warfare, civilian meaning mostly women and children. They say there is no way to withdraw now. The truth is, they never intend to withdraw. What they planned was a continuing military presence in the Middle East, control over the region, control over the oil. They had their eyes on the prize, the master plan. And what they want of the American people to remain in the dark and to keep the American people unaware of the bloodshed, the torture, and the devastation. And that is why there is an official ban, Pentagon ban on photographing the dead or the flag-draped coffins arriving home. They are determined not to repeat the same policy mistakes that were made during the Vietnam War. Not one military funeral has been attended by George Bush or his cabinet. This disregard for human life only reinforces the knowledge that this man has no heart. So I read the names in the paper. That's all we can do. If you look in your local paper, there is the little column that lists the names of the dead.
and I say them out loud, and I read the towns where they come from. And I know who they, I know the names, their ages. And Bush continues to say that we must follow through with this mission to give their lives and deaths meaning. Could there be any more terrible cynicism than that? In truth, what we owe the dead is an end to the killing. So for all of us Americans, the majority now, who don't share this administration's scorched earth brand of politics, who don't share their vision of a new America and their policies of shame, we must remain vigilant. And we will not be deterred, because what it comes down to is a question of conscience. And that question is deeply patriotic. And we must hold them accountable and make sure words like peace and freedom and compassion retain their original and essential meaning and not become taglines used by them to justify more atrocities, more killings. When I hear his empty words with phrases like armies of compassion or culture of responsibility, I understand how deep their mendacity runs. They are a lie, and they call us wrong. But I think we can be comforted, because I believe that these monstrous men and the women who condone and support them are finally on their way out. That in this, that in their chosen isolation, they are diminished and defeated men, because they do not embody the American spirit or encompass the American heart, and they do not represent the will of the people. So we must remain steadfast in our knowledge that they are wrong and we are right. And we must remain hopeful that for our children and our children's children, that we are not a warring nation, but we will embrace and practice true compassion and honor the ideals of peace and freedom, and we will not give up. Peace. Peace.
Peace, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jessica Lane. Brothers and sisters, Jessica Lane. All right. Brothers and sisters, a very quick announcement. The march is 20 blocks long. We have encircled the White House. We estimate at least already there are more than 250,000 people in the streets. You, the people, you did that. You did that. Okay.
Our next speakers are Christine Araquel from an Alliance for a Just and Lasting Peace in the Philippines, Riya Ortis from the Network in Solidarity of the People of the Philippines and the Campaign for Justice Not War in the Philippines, and Cheryl Yu from Women's Anti-Imperialist League.
My name is Christine Araquel from the Alliance for Just and Lasting Peace in the Philippines. On behalf of the Alliance for Just and Lasting Peace in the Philippines, we join and raise our voices with the thousands and thousands of people around the nation who demand money for jobs, education, and health care, not for imperialist war, occupation, and intervention in Iraq, Afghanistan, and the Philippines. Even as the Bush administration displays criminal negligence to its own citizens in New Orleans in the aftermath of the devastation of Hurricane Katrina, the U.S. continues to spend taxpayers' billions in wars of aggression and for oil and profit. Today, Bush has already offered about 2,000 American soldiers' lives in the altar of U.S. imperialist war and occupation in Iraq. In the Philippines, September 21st, 2005 marked the 33rd anniversary of one of the darkest times in the Filipino people's history. 14 years of martial law under the U.S.-supported Marcos dictatorship saw tens of thousands of murders, tortures, and disappearances, and the displacement of hundreds of thousands of Filipinos, especially the Muslims in Mindanao. Until today, U.S. military intervention is more arrogantly displayed, using the war against terror as a pretext, U.S. military openly flexes its muscles on the armed forces of the Philippines to the extent of even manning checkpoints with Filipino soldiers in some towns of Mindanao. And to further assert the U.S. military stranglehold of the U.S. Of the armed forces of the Philippines, no less an immediate past U.S. Embassy, Joseph Musumeli, said that Mindanao is next to Afghanistan as far as terrorism is concerned. Short of saying U.S. military intervention will be all over Mindanao, soon like that of Afghanistan. True to its interventionist character, the U.S. has also made its business to torpedo the peace talks between the government of the Republic of the Philippines and the National Democratic Front of the Philippines. Likewise, the illegitimate Philippine President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, a hardcore puppet of Bush, lobbied with the U.S. to label legitimate revolutionary forces as terrorists and tagged the NDF chief political consultant to the peace process, Jose Maria Cison, as a terrorist. We demand the scrapping of Jose Maria Cison's name in the list of terrorists by the U.S. and the European Council so that the peace talks can resume between the GRP and NDFP. The broad masses of the Filipino people and the Alliance for Just and Lasting Peace in the Philippines reiterated solidarity with the member organizations of International Answer Coalition and its allied organizations and demand end the colonial occupation of Iraq and Afghanistan. Bring the troops home now. U.S. out of the Middle East and the Philippines. U.S. hands off Cuba, Iran, Venezuela, and North Korea. Makibaka!
Wagmatakot!
Makibaka!
Rise up with the people of the world! This war is done in our name! Rise up with the people of the world! This war is done in our name! From the ranks of the militant and progressive Filipinos in the U.S., we support the National Mass March in Washington, D.C. to demand the end to the occupation of Iraq and U.S. intervention in other countries. We, from the Justice Not War in the Philippines campaign, believe that U.S. imperialism is the number one enemy of the world today. It promotes regimes of open terror, which are the worst kinds of terrorism. It wages wars against sovereign countries and peoples for the benefit of the U.S. banks, oil giants, and other monopoly corporations. It oppresses and exploits not only the people of other countries, but also its own working people. We all have a common interest in stopping U.S. imperialism. The terrible suffering and the unnecessary deaths of people in New Orleans is a consequence of the low priority given to working class and people of color in this country. Bush is responsible for the massive diversion of public resources towards wars of aggression and the buildup of the homeland security. It is the same Bush regime that breeds many terrorists like the Philippine President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. Arroyo cheated at the last presidential elections and abused her stolen position to manipulate the impeachment case against her. She clings to the United States to remain in power. She herself has employed the U.S. anti-terror tactics in the Philippines. Just last Thursday, a day after the 33rd anniversary of the martial law in the Philippines, Nestle Union President and labor leader Diosdado Fortuna was shot twice in the chest and died shortly afterwards. This is one of the countless cold-blooded murders under the Arroyo regime. But we, Filipinos all over the world, condemn the brutal murder of Fortuna and other atrocities under this fake and illegitimate Filipino president, just like George W. Bush. We say no to the brutal occupation of Iraq
and call for the return of the U.S. forces in the U.S. We say no to the wars of aggression and plunder of the world. We call on progressive forces in the U.S. to develop the unity of the working and poor people. We seek to forge solidarity in opposing U.S. imperialism's war of aggression for world domination. We call to develop a broad international united front to oppose imperialist war and plunder. And we will advance the struggle of the world's peoples for national liberation, democracy, social justice, development, and world peace until victory is achieved.
Yeah.
Struggle, don't be afraid.
We are the Women's Anti-Imperialist League and Gabriella Network. Because the war's collateral damage weighs most heavily on women and children, because conditions of violence increases violence against women, sex trafficking, and the constriction of women's space by fundamentalists. End the war! Bring the troops home! Because the war uses the poor as cannon fodder, from the communities of color here in the U.S. to the working poor of India, Bangladesh, Latin America, and the Philippines. Because the poor are compelled to work in the war arena of Iraq so that their families can survive in the countries themselves devastated by multinational corporations.
End the war!
Bring the troops home!
We don't need no brainwashed nation.
Thump, 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 thump.
We don't need no mind control.
Thump, 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 thump.
Blatant lies in the White House.
Thump, 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 thump.
Hey, Bush, lead us to be home.
Next, we want to bring up Attorney Lynn Stewart.
Yes, sir. You know, I'm a believer. The people, yes. I do believe in the power of the people to bring about fundamental change. I also believe in the right of people to return home, whether home is in Palestine or home is in New Orleans. Even though I now face 30 years in prison, convicted by this unjust government for doing nothing more than a lawyer is supposed to do and defend vigorously, I still believe that by fighting the case, by fighting them, by speaking today, by acting, we can defeat them and restore the right to counsel as it was understood for all these years. I believe that today will shake the very foundations of corporate greed and defeat Halliburton, Blackwater, Rove, Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, Rice. I believe. I'm a believer in resistance. I was part of a resistance that ended the war in Vietnam and now must end that same war in Iraq. I'm a believer, and you too are believers. We are not a focus group. We are the vanguard of the great progressive movement. We will bring the troops home now, because we will bring the troops home now because we must. The people, yes. Thank you.
Now, brothers and sisters, I want to introduce from the Fellowship of Reconciliation and Muslim Peace Fellowship an activist extraordinaire, Ibrahim Rimi. Big hand for Ibrahim Rimi.
Assalamu alaikum. In the name of God, most beneficent, most merciful. Look, the rain is coming, stakes are high, and time is very short. We've heard some amazing speeches. You're not going to hear one from me, but I do want to acknowledge our solidarity today with all oppressed people, with all people who struggle nonviolently for social justice, and especially with a brother whom we cannot forget, Imam Jamil Al-Amin, who is in prison unjustly. I need to mention that all political prisoners in the United States must not be forgotten by any of us in any of our movements. Now, the essential task of our movement is to stop the war system. And I want to bring to your consciousness just for a minute the work and the vision of one man that we have not heard about today, and that is Mohandas Gandhi. Gandhi understood that the essential task of stopping injustice lies with non-cooperation with evil. So say it, non-cooperation with evil. And the way that we do not cooperate with evil is that we take energy from systems of oppression and non-violently transform them into systems of justice, peace, and love. I hold up briefly today a card that says, I will not kill. It is part of a gathering of conscience and courage that we had about 9 months ago in New York that we are now turning into a national movement. Iwillnotkill.org is a way for young people all over the world to connect with the idea that stopping war requires them to say no to killing. And when you say no to killing, you say yes to justice, you say yes to peace, you say yes to economic equality, and you say yes to the end of all oppressive systems. So in closing, what I hold up is I Will Not Kill. It is a website, iwillnotkill.org. It is also a workshop that we will have at 3 o'clock in the counter-recruitment tent. So we want people who see this to relate to the fact that Muslims and Christians and Jews and people of all persuasions can stop the war system by declaring that we will not kill. We will not kill for oil. We will not kill for the Dow Jones Industrial Average. We will not kill for Halliburton, and certainly not for Mr. Bush. I will not kill. I will not kill. I will not kill.
Next, we want to bring up Andy Thayer from the Gay Liberation Network and the National Action Coordinator for DonorMen.com.
Greetings on behalf of the Gay Liberation Network from Chicago and DonorMen.com. There's only one thing worse than death itself, and that's needless death, a life wasted for no reason. Recently, the anger of the nation rose up with each image of a bloated corpse floating in the streets of New Orleans, because we knew this was needless death, death that could have been avoided, lives wasted for no reason except for bureaucratic incompetence and a stark contempt for the lives of African Americans and the poor. Multiply those lives wasted in Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama by a factor of 100, and you have the Iraq War. More than 100,000 Iraqi dead for no decent reason except for racist contempt for their lives, a class-based contempt for the lives of U.S. soldiers, and a base desire to expand U.S. power abroad. Now, Bush and his allies in the Republican and Democratic part leadership say the war is about building democracy in the Middle East. Well, we in the gay community know something about your so-called democracy, Mr. Bush, and we don't buy it. We know what it's like to have our lives wasted due to bigoted contempt, as when the government ignored the AIDS crisis for years and allowed it to grow into the largest epidemic in world history. And when Bush says his killing is about spreading democracy, we take note of the kind of democracy he spreads in this country when he pushes for constitutional amendments against the gay people of our country. We see the kind of democracy he embraces when he embraces the Saudi monarchy, which hangs gay people. And we see, Mr. Bush, and your Democratic and Republican allies, we do not buy your democracy. We know what this war is about, and we say no more wasted lives.
Thanks. Next, I want to bring up Jeruba Hill from Mississippi, Brenda Stokely, and Amiri Baraka.
We're an hour backed up here.
Half hour. Again, Jeruba Hill from Mississippi, Brenda Stokely, and Amiri Baraka.
It's raining out here, but it's not raining on the kind of movement that has to be built. Sister Jeruba Hill is a long-standing activist working with workers in Mississippi and now working with those who are affected by the Gulf and the Gulf hurricane. And I don't need to introduce Amina Baraka, who has been around for a long time. We're coming up here together because it's very important to talk about the continuity of a principle struggle, one that is not reaped with opportunism, one that is not reaped with a competition, one that is not reaped with sectarianism. That is not the kind of movement that's going to save the lives of brothers and sisters in Iraq or down in the Gulf region.
Right,
we cannot afford that. We must have one movement that is principled, that is united, and that's not about stars and not about C-SPAN. The movement ain't gonna be, the revolution ain't gonna be televised. It's gonna be organized in our communities. I'm gonna turn it over to my sister Jeribu, my brother Baraka. Stand strong, do not tolerate in whatever group that you're part of, that there is this kind of divisive, stupid, asinine behavior that has nothing to do with building a strong, united movement.
Right.
Fight against it. Build unity. Build a broad movement. Defeat racism. Bring our troops home and save the people that are in the Gulf region. Thank you.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. I bring you greetings and solidarity from the state of Mississippi, the wretched state of Mississippi, the state that Bush forgot about, the state that says loud and clear that racism is alive and well, that an attack and assault on poor people is alive and well, that human rights abuses in the United States of America are alive and well. Since people were brought here as human cargo to now, that has never changed. And we have brothers and sisters on the Gulf Coast of Mississippi who didn't have anything before, and they have even less now. We have brothers and sisters in New Orleans who are hanging on rooftops because they've been forgotten. They've been left out of the Red Cross. They've been left out of the Salvation Army. They've been left out of FEMA. And we have to stand with those brothers and sisters and chastise the U.S. government for making sure that poor people stay poor and rich people stay rich. Fight against it. Fight against worldwide poverty. Struggle alongside those that don't have anything except their struggle. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
Thank you. I just got finished sitting in a train station for 5 hours. They cancel all the Amtrak trains coming south. That's why somebody said it was a coincidence. First, I must confess that I'm a communist. So that makes me black and red and sometimes blue. But I understand that this is not the period when Mao Zedong said revolution is the main trend in the world today. Today, counter-revolution is the main trend, along with revisionism, betrayal, and neo-fascism marching across the world with the pop art moniker globalization. And although I am a communist, I will admit readily that we cannot stop this neo-fascist poison of Bush-led U.S. superpower world dictatorship of the most imperialist, the most jingoistic, the most racist element of finance capital by ourselves. Nor can any of you, none of your organizations, whether you are a nationalist, a vegetarian, a Democrat, a Republican, anti-imperialist, none of us can stop them alone. We must build a united front. We must build a united front. We must build a permanent, stable, national united front of all the anti-imperialist parties, organizations, institutions, publications, tendencies in this country, aligned with and allied to like groups around the world. Otherwise, if we don't, domestic fascism in the United States is very probable. I would add, as an even more dire comment, that unless the Afro-American people can pull together a united front, which is national in character, to go with such an all-American, multinational, united front, fascism in the United States is definite. I say these things because even though we are here for an anti-war rally, we have got to begin to understand that as long as imperialism exists, war will be a permanent phenomenon on the planet. I'm opposed to imperialist wars, wars of annexation and profit, but I'm not opposed to a people's war against imperialism, monopoly capitalism, national oppression, and racism, because that is the only way these scourges will be eliminated. And the only way to set the stage for the elimination of these crimes against humanity is to fight against sectarianism, as the sister said, to struggle to bring together all those of us who oppose imperialism in the North American People's Democratic Congress, where we can, from the stable base of national anti-imperialist organization, which must become an institution, create an alternative superstructure, successfully alter the political culture of this country, and overthrow the 0.6% that rule our lives and most of the people on this planet. A stable, anti-imperialist, united front and organization. And in addition, we must create a broad cultural revolution so that people can take back the expression of their lives from the five maniacal media corporations that have created an imperialist commercial culture of filth, reaction, lies, and pornography. They have gotten so bold that now they're attacking science itself. So I got somebody tapping me on the shoulder, so I have to leave. Only thing I want to say is that you know the war on terror is a sham. They say they're bringing democracy to Iraq. Why don't they start with New Orleans? That would help. And also, since 9/11, they have been able to attack Afghanistan, pull Palestinian ethnic cleansing, Iraq, and now they're talking about the axis of evil. But I want to point out that these assholes of evil that are in Washington, they're, why is it that all of their axis of evil are all colored people? That's why they have Negro Secretary of State to run around threatening people, including Venezuela and Cuba. The class struggle is intensifying every moment in this country. The principal terrorists in the world today are in the White House, the Pentagon, and Congress. The persons with the closest relationship to the Bin Laden family is the Bush family. We have to stop the imperialist war, but we must begin to seriously find ways to unite these parties and organizations and institutions and tendencies of this country who move even further to the right. We must stop the war, but we must also stop Bush, stop imperialism, stop national oppression and racism if we are to stop the war. In fact, I want to end with this little poem of mine, a loku, which is like a haiku. This is called Loku for Bush 2. The main thing wrong with you is you ain't in jail. Unite to stop the war. Unite to put Bush in jail. Unite to smash imperialism, national oppression, racism, and all reaction. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Hello, family. I tell you, this day is just so good as we look over to the parade at the march
It's moving. Part of the difficulties have been all the streets that have been closed out and other situations. We hope you understand that. From this lectern, we're about an hour over in terms of speakers and what is planned. United for Peace and Justice, we are. This is a weekend of events. Our Peace and Justice Festival is across the street at the Washington Monument. We have 18 interactive tents, theme tents. We invite you to come over. Tents around Iraq, around Israel, Palestine, around counter-military recruiting, around the war here at home. Please join us over there. Tomorrow on Sunday, the festival continues. There'll be also an entertainment stage of 7 hours at the Sylvan Theater. There'll be training for grassroots lobbying. We have a record of more than 100 districts registered to lobby at our congressional people to end this occupation and bring our troops home. That is just tremendous. 100 legislative districts registered to lobby. Also tomorrow, there'll be training for nonviolent civil disobedience. We ask you to join us on Monday, lobbying at the White House, at Congress, nonviolent civil disobedience targeted at the White House. Please join us right now. Because we are so backed up and under the situation, United for Peace and Justice, our last group of speakers, will speak at the free concert beginning at 3 o'clock in 20 minutes across the street. Again, we invite you to join us across the street. United for Peace and Justice, we are. We say end this occupation now. We say leave no more military bases behind. We say stop the torture. We say fund human needs here at home. We say justice to the people of the Gulf Coast in the occupation. Bring our troops home now. Join us across the street, United for Peace and Justice.
We're here with the Answer Coalition. We know people are getting tired, but we've got some very important speakers left that have helped build this demonstration and bring these hundred thousands of people into the street. So next I want to bring up Hadi Jawad with the Crawford Peace House.
Hi, greetings from Crawford, Texas. Just to let you know that Crawford, Texas ain't Bush country no more. The Crawford Peace House says no to the Bush agenda of endless war, war profiteering, and military domination of Arabs and Arabs' land. Do you realize that fully 10% of all Arabs and Arab lands are now under military occupation of the U.S. and its allies? We say, end the occupation! End the occupation! End the occupation! We say the time has come for the nightmare of the Iraqi people to end. The Iraqi people have been suffering for too long. For too long the Iraqi people have been suffering. Let Iraq live! Let Iraq live! Let Iraq live! Let Iraq live! We say that the time has come, that there are no more gold star moms and dads. So we demand we honor the wishes of the Iraqi people. We demand that all troops are removed from Iraq. Troops out now! Troops out now! Troops out now! Thank you very much and God bless. Let Iraq live! Let Iraq live! Let Iraq live!
Next, we want to bring up representatives from Bayan, USA.
I'll do Larry Holmes and we're out of here. Larry? Larry? Larry?
Larry? Isang mainit at mapagpalayang pagbati sa inyong lahat, mga kasama mula sa Bayan, USA! Warm, militant, and liberating greetings to you, brothers and sisters! From the ranks of Bagong Alyansang Makabayan and the Filipino people's struggle for national democracy in the Philippines. Brothers and sisters, we are here today pushes war abroad. And if we are going to shut this war down, we must shut it down in all its forms. That's why we are calling for the immediate ouster of Gloria Macapagal Arroyo as part of the comprehensive call to oust U.S. war of aggression. We have a legitimate hope, brothers and sisters. As Filipino people with a long history of struggle, we have a legitimate hope in unity. We have seen the concrete gains of unity oust two U.S. puppets from the Philippines. And we know that U.S. war of aggression is a force to be reckoned with. It is a force that believes by killing our leaders, it can kill our movement. But they are wrong. They can kill our leaders, but they cannot kill the people's movement. And we are here with you as Filipinos with the spirit of our martyrs, with the spirit of Ding Fortuna, with the spirit of Aden Marceliana, with the spirit of Eddie Gumanoy, to say if people power can oust the U.S. puppet, and it will. People power on a worldwide scale can oust U.S. war. Can oust U.S. war. Oust the Bush Arroyo regime. U.S. troops out of the Philippines. Stop the killings. No to U.S.-sponsored martial law. Long live international solidarity! Long live international solidarity! Maraming salamat! Thank you!
Next is Ricardo Santos from the Socialist Front of Puerto Rico.
Comrades, As a member of the Socialist Front of Puerto Rico, I knew that it was very important to travel to D.C. during this day and during this manifestation of protest against imperialism. As Puerto Ricans, we know how the U.S. government take our youth to die in other countries for unjust reasons. This was going to be the subject of my speech today, but recent news coming from Puerto Rico obligate me to speak of other related matters. Puerto Rico was invaded by the U.S. troops in 1898. Since then, we have been a colony of the U.S. For more than 100 years, thousands of Puerto Ricans have fought in many ways to overthrow the colonial and capitalist system in Puerto Rico. International law, and more important, common sense, give us the right to fight, as Malcolm X once said, by any means necessary. Yesterday, one of our most known freedom fighters was killed by the FBI, Filiberto Ojeda Rios, leader of the Ejército Popular Boricua Macheteros, was in the list of the FBI most wanted for more than a decade. The FBI goal was not to arrest him, but to kill him. They wait until yesterday, the day that we commemorate our first rising against the Spaniard tyranny, to make a statement of power and impunity to all the independentist movement. As independentists, we know that there's a great difference between the U.S. government and you, the people who live and build this great nation. That is why I am sure of your solidarity to free Puerto Rico and all our political prisoners, the same way that we felt your support to get to the Navy out of our island of Vieques. I have no doubt that the people of this nation will help us to raise conscious of the tyranny and absence of democracy in Puerto Rico. Viva Puerto Rico libre y socialista! Compañero Filiberto Ojeda Ríos, Presente. Paz a Iraq. Paz para Palestina.
Thank you. Our final speaker, and believe me, we've had quite a few today, but our final speaker is an activist extraordinaire. Please greet Larry Holmes with Troops Out Now.
Troops Out Now Coalition. Sisters and brothers, it's my privilege to close out this long, long rally. Let me make this point. I know that everyone is angry, certainly at this protest, about Katrina. It really was Katrina's side. When will we have unity in the movement? We're moving toward it. We'll have unity when the 250,000 people that we had in a day or more are also willing to come out and demonstrate against racism and stand side to side with the survivors of Katrina and New Orleans and throughout the Gulf Coast. That's the direction that we have to move in. But this is a start. I want to congratulate the coalitions for putting this together. Unity is difficult. We need it. Let me end by reminding you of an important anniversary that's coming up. This year will mark the 50th anniversary of the day that a sister by the name of Rosa Parks, a garment worker, civil rights activist in Montgomery, Alabama, refused to give her seat to a white man on a bus, which was against the law then. And she was arrested. Her act of defiance sparked what we call the Montgomery boycott. I don't have time to give you a history lesson on that. Some of you know about it. The others should go find out about it, because it lasted longer than a year. It involved about 40,000 African-American workers and supporters from outside of their community. And it was the struggle that launched the modern civil rights movement. There would have been no 63 March. No freedom rides if it were not for the Montgomery bus boycott and Rosa Parks. I might add, it also introduced to the world a young minister by the name of Reverend Martin Luther King, who became the principal spokesperson for that boycott. We've been talking, many activists around the country, about what can we do to commemorate December 1, 1955, when December 1, 2005 comes up. We have formed a committee. We call it the Rosa Parks Anniversary Strike Against Poverty, Racism, and War. And the idea is to have a nationwide strike against the war on that day. Wouldn't that honor the memory of Rosa and what she did? The idea is for the students not to go to school, and people not to shop, and maybe picket in front of stores so that nobody will shop there, and for working people not to go to work. It's a big step. But the point is, Katrina means we've got to up the ante. We've got to think in terms of trying to shut the war down. And that means no business as usual. And that means taking lessons from the past. And as important as these humongous rallies are, that's just one tactic, no substitute. But there are other things. So find out more about this. Stay connected. Listen to good brothers like Mahdi Bray, hardworking. He's one of the people who tries to keep the movement together, you know, and does a good job, because it's difficult. Sisters and brothers, go in peace, but you've got more work to do. You've got more work to do when you go home. Go to those armories where in your community, whether it's Detroit or Chicago or right here in the armory in Washington, D.C., where they've got evacuees from New Orleans. Show them that you support them, but not just by bringing them water, which they may need. Go there and demonstrate for their right to be able to go back to New Orleans and have a job and decent housing and get some of those hundreds of billions of dollars that Bush is giving his friends in Halliburton. This united with the anti-war movement, the struggle against the war abroad, against our Palestinian sisters and brothers, against our Iraqi sisters and brothers, and against people of color right here. That's the kind of movement we need. Are we going to have that kind of movement?